My sincerest, and on behalf of the entire Wild Earth team, our sincerest apologies for the attack of the gremlins that appear to have happened this afternoon. Personally, I blame Gendre. I feel as though...
Thanks, Jamie.
It's a pleasure, Gendre. It's either Gendre or Jerry, both of whom, of course, arrived back before the afternoon drive. It's not me, because the gremlins did not attack this morning, as far as I know. So it was absolutely fine this morning, therefore it's not me, and the only other logical explanation is that Gendre or Geraldine brought it back with them. I did see Mr. Hendry driving back in with Dave and Peter Bratt. Oh, and Ian, actually. Ian's here as well, so it could be any of those suspects, but it's not me. I am innocent. It is a day of many newcomers and many people disappearing. We've had quite the changeover of staff. Anyway, Sindile is completely unfazed by our problematic moments with the gremlins. And as you can see, he is snoozing quite peacefully on his termite mound. He's perfectly relaxed, but he is restless and he is keeping a close eye on us. So we're going to settle with our lovely view of him from here for now. And we'll just let him have as much space as he needs. He does look like he's got the best spot this afternoon, which of course a leopard is very good at, but he's found himself a really nice shady patch in the shelter of that termite mound. While our lovely leopard snoozes away his full belly in the shade from the afternoon sun, let's go and find out what reptilian species Steph has managed to find.
See if you can guess what that is, just from the tip of the tail. It's saying hello to us for the first time after being asleep for many, many weeks. Have a look at that. One of our dragons. Look at those claws, body, just sunning himself. A beautiful white-throated monitor. Just come out of a slumber, warming up. Spent a winter in, not in a type of hibernation, but in a much reduced state of consciousness, almost unconscious. And he's now just climbed out in this late afternoon to metabolize a little bit of the energy that he would have stored up last year. And just have a look at his tail, the base of his tail. And his back was where he would have stored all the fat. And you can see how skinny that tail is. You can see how it's got this dip. That is where the fat reserves were being built up. And by the end of summer, hopefully you'll have a nice fat tail again and a nice broad back. You can see that skin line there. That's, he can fill that entire fold of skin, literally, and needs to in the days of summer. And he will do that overpowering and eating absolutely anything they can, from snakes to birds, eggs, insects, termites, if they're a little bit bigger, humans, Land Rovers, small buildings, fire engines, and Boeing 747s. I'm sure these guys think they can tackle it all. And they do so by running after their prey, overpowering it with just sheer strength and bite force and those massive claws. Just had enough holding on with his fingernails and is now just climbing up onto a branch, probably just to rest out a little bit. Yeah, his face is peeling, he's peering over the edge. Look at that tongue, testing everything with that tongue. Tongue is very long, quite sticky and forked. And the reason why it's forked is in the roof of this lizard's mouth, basically underneath that white spot that you have, that he has just by his eye, are two pits. And so the tongue comes out, waves in the air, picks up scent particles, will then go back into the mouth, and then he flicks it forward, and the two tips of his tongue then go into the holes in the roof of his mouth, and he wipes off the glands very in a pit that's jam-packed with sensory organelle. He's now going back into his hibernation hole, where he came from. You'll see him disappear in there now, being very careful. He doesn't want to fall. He's using those very viciously hooked claws. And let's see if he goes in there. Just just an absolutely fantastic sighting of this white-throated monitor. You can have a look at their hands, his hands, or his four legs, four claws. You can see those claws that are very long. Exceptional sense of smell, can smell rot. He's not outside of the possibilities of scavenging off a carcass, using sense of smell and his eyesight to catch and locate prey. Very, very strong animals. You can pick them up. He's a large animal. He's Africa's third, let's say, he's the second largest lizard, because the water monitor gets slightly longer, and one of the world's largest lizards, with the Komodo dragon being the world's largest, at probably 3 to 4 times his length and easily, I don't know, 50 times his size. Komodo dragons are just something else entirely. That camouflage, resting up against the tree. Wow, expat, you've just sent through a comment saying you watched one on the Juma cam once digging up terrapin eggs. That's fantastic. I've never seen anything like it. I know they do eat eggs. They've got a big fondness for eggs, but having seen that and witnessed that, that's very special. Never in all the thousands of hours I've been out in the bush have I been lucky enough to see that. So hope that's one for the memory banks. Oh, he's just fantastic. Oh, Beard, you've just asked me how many species, well, firstly, hello, and secondly, you just asked me how many species of monitor lizard we have in the country. We've got two. We've got the water monitor, or the Nile monitor, as it's sometimes called, and then we've got the rock monitor, or the white-throated monitor, as this one is called. Those are the only two that we have in the country, with this one being the more terrestrial one, and the rock monitor being the more amphibious one. You find these monitor lizards all over the bushveld. They're a fairly common bushveld lizard. You don't always see them, but they are a fairly common bushveld lizard. And this fare, see if he's, oh, you can just see his claws there on his back foot holding on there. Hey, look at that claw just holding on. One of the favorite foods of a martial eagle is this guy, and there's lots of footage on YouTube where the teeth and claws of these monitor lizards are pitted against the bills and claws of the martial eagle, and you can go and have a look at how many titanic battles between these dragons and martial eagles have been filmed over the years. I've seen a martial eagle be dragged across a road by one of these guys before. Incredibly strong. That's his ear hole that you can see there behind his eye. Fairly large, with no external ear flaps. Definitely no family of mine then. And just once again, I just have to remark on those five-fingered claws, just wickedly tipped with those claws. Just a fantastic sighting of this monitor lizard. Really has to be one of the best sightings. Kathy, you absolutely right. I'm also going to join you in that statement. You've just said that you're going to enjoy spring with all these creatures that arrive, and that is 100% why I enjoy summer so much. It's just the diversity here is just so fantastic. You got from these dragons all the way through to the most minute, interesting insect. And all the flowers and all the birds come back, and all the vibrancy in the plants, the clouds that build up in the sky. I really am looking forward to summer again, I must be honest with you. But then, you know, when we're in summer and we're battling with the heat and you've sweated for 4 weeks non-stop, then you also miss these massive blue skies and the chillier weather. Let's see if we can go forward a little bit. I suppose that's just the nature of humans, never to be completely satisfied. Hey, Now, we're not particularly sneaky in a 2-ton Land Rover, but let's just see what we can get right here. Let's see if we can show you his nest. RJ, you've just asked me if these lizards shed like snakes. They absolutely do. They are cold-blooded and they will outgrow their old skin and shed it off. It doesn't come off quite as neatly as a snake. They slough it off and then they rub it. Have a look at his, obviously very comfortable with us now. That blunt nose, another diagnostic feature of this particular species. And those scales all over his body. If we're very careful, we might even be able to see a parasite or two. Have a look at that eye. Oh, and he's got an injury on his head and missing some scales. You can actually see us in his eyeball. That pair of white shorts that you're looking at is on Bebop's legs. And you can even see our aerial. That is amazing. He's had enough of being a point of discussion at the moment. He's going back around to the other side of the tree. That's the hole he came out of. Look at those claws there. Turning around. So Dina, you said that you don't really know anything about monitor lizards, and please excuse me, I haven't furnished anything except the most common. They do have the Komodo dragons have a venomous saliva, the rock monitors do not, but they've got an incredibly hard bite. They overpower their prey, which includes anything. Anything that they can catch and kill, they will do so. They use their claws, which you can see there. I mean, that is just something out of a horror movie. To grab and dig with. They don't kill with their claws, they just hold tight, and then the power comes from the bite, and then they shake the prey with their head. They'll thrash it from side to side, usually dismembering whatever they've got, swallowing it whole. They will eat near anything. They mate once a year. They lay eggs in the sides of termite mounds or at the bases of trees, and those eggs incubate for an entire year, and then they hatch with the first spring rains, as the rains soften the soil and the length of day is longer, they will come out and will immediately begin hunting. No parental care whatsoever once this female or male has done their job of laying eggs made the lady lizard pregnant. Jeez, my brain is being fried by the sun over here and I've lost my ability to communicate in the English language. You can see that the gape is fairly wide, got quite a wide opening mouth, and no fangs, just the serrated teeth. He's heard something, seen something. Let's see if it's not a martial eagle. No, not a martial eagle. He would be very wary of being caught in the open. I have seen leopard catch and kill these monitor lizards. I haven't seen lion do it. In actual fact, Mvula was the last leopard I saw catch one of these monitor lizards last season. Other than that, they really are dragons. I mean, if you were the size of a mouse or a rat and this dragon came upon you, there is much to be feared. Look at that ant he's allowed crawling on his head. Oh. Let's see if we can spot any parasites in his ear opening. Yes, there's one or two ticks in there, I can see. Am I wrong? Is it just because I want to see it? Look at all those scales as well. Just massive scales. Gee whiz. This is the closest I've ever been to a monitor lizard. It is an incredible sighting. There's his nose. Very acute sense of smell, but he'd use his tongue. And look at those claws. Oh, imagine this thing was the size of a Nile crocodile. Wouldn't be that many humans on the planet, that's for sure. And those very powerful forelegs, they use their legs for digging primarily. And the muscle fibers that you have inside inside reptiles are much more densely packed than what mammalian muscle fibers are, and so it gives them an incredibly hard or incredibly powerful ability. Their musculature is incredibly powerful. He has his back legs stretched out there to his pelvis and then his tail. He's skinny. You can see how much skin he's actually got. And then they've got this short stubby tail as well, not a very long one, with those keeled scales. That's what when we're talking about a snake that can climb a tree easily, and we talk about keeled scales, that is a keeled scale that you're looking at on the tail there. His back leg is stretched out, hooking on the branch with the claws. And then look at all those wrinkles that he's got in his belly and his back. There on the tummy. That's to facilitate growth. So they can bolt food down, and really they can do a lot of food in one sitting. Easily devour a complete clutch of eggs. Let's see where he goes up the tree now. See if his tongue comes out again. They've got the most unbelievable tongue. Very, very, very nice. Now, you asked if it was dangerous to humans. It's not really dangerous to humans, although they can curl their tail, and I've had one lash out at me before. They curl their tail in a characteristic S, and they whip it out at you, and it can knock you. I mean, it's not that sore, to be honest. It just gives you more of a fright. And then they can use their claws to rake you if you catch one, and then they bite as well. They've got a very, very strong bite. I have a fond memory of sticking a stick into a hole that had one in, and he bit the end of the stick, and I couldn't even turn or rotate the stick. Can you believe it? A bite there that'll easily take off your finger or do you some damage, at least, at all. Do we utilize them in any way? Absolutely. They have been used as food for people. You can eat their flesh. It tastes a bit like chicken, but then I think anything tastes like chicken if you don't want to really think about it. But it is a white, fatty meat. And just have a look at that. Farah, you're 100% right. These close-ups on this new camera that we've got is just unbelievable. We were just commenting on it now. The amount of things that we can show you with this particular camera is just wonderful. I have to say thank you to everybody that helped make the purchase of this possible. It's just opening up such a massive new world to everyone. Have a look at the way his scales behind his head are very different to the scales on top of his head. I have no idea why. I don't see enough of these guys or know enough about herpetology to actually tell you anything more than I have, really. Oh, I do know that they've got a pineal eye. That I can tell you. Most reptiles, especially ones this large, have got a third eye. It's located in the top of the head. There's an indent just at the back of his skull. Let's see if he'll allow us to see it again, giving us this stare over his shoulder. You'll see on top of his skull there's a slight indent. That is a very thin portion of the skull, and there's just below the skin, through a very thin piece of bone, there's a third eye that is light sensitive. And they use that third eye to judge light intensity and length of day. So it can actually see, not well, I mean it doesn't see patterns or anything like that, but lizards have got a third eye in the middle of their head. I just found that a fantastic fact. So pineal eye that the monitor has used to judge light intensity and length of day. He's just tolerating us here. They're very good swimmers. They use their tail. You can see his tail's actually flattened dorso-ventrally, which means that it's squashed on the side. You'll see there it's round, but as you go up to the swimming part of it, it becomes squashed top to bottom, well, squashed in the sides, and they'll swish that from side to side. They swim incredibly well. There's all the fatty deposits. That's where it was stored, and in his back, just in front of his hip, there is where he stores lots of fat over the course of the summer, feeding pretty much non-stop. They're cold-blooded, so they operate within a range of temperatures. Too hot, they die. Too cold, they die. Just right, although they don't have a set body temperature like we do. We've got a set body temperature of 37 degrees centigrade, 2 degrees up. We run the risk of overheat and dying, and 2 degrees down, and we also risk the same. Most reptiles can do a couple of dozen degrees, 10 degrees or so, up or down. Just have a look at the ease. He's just scaling this marula tree vertically. Very camouflaged against the bark. As I said, the Marshall Eagle is his main predator, and then also Honey Badger will also catch and eat him. I'd love to see a fight between a Honey Badger and a large monitor. I mean, if he can give a Marshall Eagle a run for his money, imagine what a Honey Badger is going to... Both of them being probably the most stubborn of all African carnivores. This one and a Honey Badger. Just look at now, we've got such a view of that forearm on the right hand side. Just have a look at all that muscle holding that hand together. He'd give Popeye a run for his money with those huge forearms. Popeye forearm. I don't even know if those cartoons play anymore. All right, so I think we're going to leave this guy alone. What we don't want to do is overstay our welcome here. No matter how much we try, we do have an effect on these animals. And I think what we'll do is leave him in peace, let him get back to the sunny side of the tree and do whatever he was going to do. Let me roll gently forward before I start the car and scare him. There we go. Ah. Brian, you've just asked me when the tortoise is going to come out of hibernation. Soon. As soon as there's enough food to eat. So tortoises are in hibernation because they need grass to eat, they need plants to eat, and they need water. And they'll stay in hibernation until those three things happen. And I don't think we're going to see very many tortoises this month, although this month has ended. We'll probably see tortoises towards the end of September, beginning of November again, with the most tortoises coming out in proper summertime. So from the 1st of November to the 1st of April is when we see most of our tortoises out here. Let's see what this yellow-billed hornbill is going to do to this patch of elephant dung. They've been so comical lately with their lifting up of dung and feeding on termites, and this one is exactly not disappointing us, picking up termites furiously. Just have a look at that. Now, why is picking them up so furiously? It's because the termites will be hastily retreating underground even as we speak. And for him to get the most benefit for having flown all the way down here and then used his massive chisel beak to lift up the piece of elephant dung, he will need to feed on them all and as much as he can before they all disappear. And that is exactly why he's so furiously picking up all of those termites. And the termites obviously using the elephant dung for its source of moisture and also the wood. Just have a look at that. Southern yellow-billed hornbill, that is what we're looking at right here, and from the looks of things, a male with that red throat patch under the beak. And a full-grown male as well. One of my favorite birds, always busy doing something, very industrious, and comes from literally one of the most successful bird families that we have out here, the hornbills, from thick jungle all the way onto nearly the sand deserts in Namibia. And he's using the very tip of his beak there. Oh, just look at that. Good looking bird. Wide stance. A friend of mine once brought one up that had was missing a wing, and this bird used to run riot in her house. And then using his one wing and his little stump that he had left of his other wing, he used to climb right to the top of the tallest tree in her garden and sit there the whole day and make noises and jump from branch to branch and then come back down and then absolutely ruin her house. Every single bit in her house, every inch of her house was inspected every day, even though he had a bowl full of food presented to him by basically my entire guarding staff. Would catch grasshoppers on the soccer field all day and bring it to this hornbill. He all had a soft spot for this little guy. He eventually just walked off into the bush, had enough. The way he uses his beak. Now, from a nutrition point of view, insect protein is about 3 times more or higher in protein than what mammal protein is. Maybe calories, I don't know what I want to say there, but it's give you a ratio, 100 grams of termites is equal to 300 grams of beef. So this hornbill being able to feed and have the strength to pick apart this bolus of elephant dung is giving himself the absolute advantage. He's not flying around, he's not flapping, he's not using those giant chest muscles to get himself into the air. He's just using his brain and his curiosity and the tool, a massive crowbar on his face. And you can see, when everything else out here is drab and looking shoddy, these guys are still in tip-top condition. Paul, I agree with you. It is pretty amazing that he can pick up tiny termites with that huge beak. But if you have a careful look, not easy to see with the view we have now, but you'll see that his eyes are actually binocular, meaning that they are slightly pointed forward. He's got a good peripheral vision, much like a chicken would, I suppose, but his eyes do point slightly forward so he can judge depth. And he's actually picking up the termites with the very tip of his beak, and then throwing them into his mouth. And he's doing that because he can see the very tip of his beak and he can see it in 3 dimensions. So he knows it's like your finger picking up something small. He can see it, he can judge distance, and he can accurately aim and place his beak where it needs to be. What's fascinating for me is the speed at which he's doing it. I don't know how he's selecting another target. He's picking them up so quickly. Maybe he's just randomly pecking, but I doubt it. Seems like I'm never going to get rid of this particular one. UK expat, you've just asked me if I had any ill effects from drinking the juice I squeezed out of a fresh elephant dung. No, I didn't actually. Apart from this lingering taste of elephant dung juice on my lips, my beard, and on my gums, I suppose. I'm just remembering it now, fondly licking my teeth, which taste like sun cream and toothpaste now, and not like elephant dung. But no, I didn't even have a tummy rumble, not even one, which is a bit worrisome. But goes to show that it couldn't have been too bad for me. I don't think I'd like a cup of freshly squeezed elephant dung every day with my breakfast, to be quite honest with you. It had a slight sort of oily texture to it. But would I do it again? Absolutely. Would I do it in a survival situation for others? Without a doubt. Did it work? Yeah. Well, it was the only surface water that we had around us, and I got a good half a snail shell out of one bolus. If I had squeezed all of the dung there, I would have gotten easily 2 cups of water out of that one elephant dung. With the benefit of having all those nutrients, probably some vitamin rocket ship into my system. Or I'd like to tell myself that at least anyway. This guy is just going at it. And I don't want to disturb the poor guy, but I mean, he's going to be so heavy he won't be able to fly. He's going to sleep right here next to the elephant dung soon. Amazing. There's no other birds that have come to join him, which is bizarre. Usually when one bird finds a food source like this, other birds quickly follow. And the fact that he hasn't been chased off here by a bigger hornbill, or been joined by a bunch of juvenile hornbills, or for that matter of fact by any other bird out here that loves termites, is just incredible. Testimony to how hot it actually is, to be honest. Mr. R. Beard, you said you still have ill effects just thinking about me drinking that elephant dung. The only thing I can say is sorry. And when you get here, please feel free to try a cup for yourself and see if the anticipation of it is worse than the actual event. Just look at that beak that he's got. He's actually got some cracks. It's a full grown hornbill, this. And you probably find that he's learnt over the last couple of years exactly what works for him. It's very good. See that wide stance? That is just so typically yellow-billed hornbill, standing with their legs almost too wide open. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. Now, these guys have another interesting trait. The females, well, together the pair will select a hole in a tree, a suitable hole or cavity in a tree. The female then goes into the hole and pulls out most of her primary feathers to line the nest. What happens then is that the male and the female, using a mixture of mud and her own feces, will then, and discarded insect husks and whatever else they can find, will plaster up the entrance to that nest, leaving just a gap for her beak. He then spends the remainder of the time between then and when the last chick emerges ferrying food to her and the brood. And once the babies hatch, not all the eggs hatch at the same time, because they're not all laid at the same time. They're laid maybe a day or two apart. And what will happen is he keeps on fetching and carrying food, fetching and carrying food, while the female, oh, there he goes, he's had enough. Good for you. He's probably food drunk by now, wiping his beak clean. Still hungry. Insane. He fetches and carries food basically to the hole. Babies, the youngsters, keep on building the nest up. The fledged chicks keep on breaking it down. And then finally, the final straw is when mom's primary feathers have grown back. She then breaks open the nest and the family emerges. Seems to be quite successful, because there's a lot of hornbills around here, to be honest with you. But if the male dies or gets caught, the entire family dies. That is the downside of that particular breeding strategy. Just look at this guy. He's now flicked away a buffalo dung. And I can actually see the termites running for their lives. You can see it on the ground in front of him. Just have a look at them scurrying for their lives. And he is just bashing his face at them. Just look at them go. No wonder he's in such a frenzy. They're also in a frenzy. Wow, what a dinner this guy is getting. I wonder if he does this every day. Do you think he needs to have a varied diet? I would imagine he does it every day. Do you think these termites are fighting back in his crop? Amazing. What a absolutely fantastic sighting of this hornbill, just on the back of a fantastic sighting with a white-throated monitor. This has been an incredible stretch of road for us this afternoon. But we have left Jamie out of the picture for a little bit, and as far as I know, she's back on the road again with Jandre, and I'm sure has a plan going forward, which she'd like to tell you. So we'll catch up in a little bit. See you later.
I do indeed have a really exciting plan that I would like to share with you. There is a reason that I have left Young Sundile. First, well, there's two actually. The first is that there are other vehicles that would like to come and see him. The second is that wonderful Herbert has done it once again, as have the lovely Nkuhumas. And I've just got a report that he has tracked down the Nkuhumas, who have at some point during the day, between morning and afternoon, killed a buffalo in the middle of the block. Now we're just sort of making our way, slowly but surely meandering. I might even stop to have a look at these lovely impala while we wait, because we're just waiting for our chance to go into that sighting. And I just couldn't resist going back to see how much those Nkuhuma cubs have grown. I'm so excited to go and see them. Jandre, are you excited? Yes. How could one not be? We do have a lovely impala herd here at the Pumped Pan at Vuyatela Dam. Now just bear with me, I need to just listen to the game drive comms, and these two are having a bit of a box, hopefully, and keep us distracted so I can listen, because it sounds as though it's a very difficult sighting to get into. So I just, oh, look at that. Dust clouds flying, wow. The clash of their horns, this is incredible. Ah, and the victor. Oh, and it has sparked off a riot of male impala, making their peculiar rutting sounds and chasing each other. Round and round, dust clouds flying. I don't want to be the one to tell them that mating season's over and this is all for nothing, but they seem to be keeping each other so thoroughly entertained. The funniest part of that whole sighting, which only I could see, was while they're making that very peculiar grunting sounds that seem so very incongruous to such a gorgeous, a dainty antelope, there was one young male with sort of tiny, pointy horns that decided he was going to join in and then got terrified and ran away. And just like that, it's over. Peace returns to the world of the impala rams. That we've just come out of their breeding season. In fact, I say just, it's been a few months since we've come out of their breeding season. Around May, June, we get that all the time. The males constantly sparring, fighting each other, often with some serious injuries as a result. But now they're just letting off a little bit of steam, I think, enjoying a nice afternoon battle, and so terribly atmospheric with the sun sort of billowing in the reflection of the dust. I just want to see something. Let's just have a look at this impala on the right here, this ram on the right. He is absolutely covered in oxpeckers. Now, generally, because they move about in groups, those birds that are busy picking off the ectoparasites, or the ticks, on his fur, they might all be part of the same family of oxpeckers. But sometimes you find when you have an ill antelope, they have a higher tick count than normal. Whether it's injured or something's wrong with it, it's not quite fully healthy. He looks fine to me, though. And sometimes you see more oxpeckers gathered on that particular animal than others. He's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, one on each leg, 10. That's a lot of oxpeckers for one small antelope. Oh, there's even more on the other side. My goodness. That might be a record for the number of oxpeckers I've seen on an impala before. Lots and lots of them riding on their host's back and enjoying whatever external parasites he's managed to pick up. I don't think he's ill. He looks fine to me. He's in perfectly good condition. It might just be that that's just one family of oxpeckers. They are cooperative breeders, So the offspring of one generation will stick around and help their parents with the next generation of offspring. But he certainly does seem to be playing, doing the lift club. It's his turn to host the Oxpeckers. Now, as soon as I have a moment, I would like to chat on the Game Drive channel, but that's proving to be relatively difficult. So what we'll do is we'll just start making our way in the direction of those lions. And the reason I'm contorting myself like a mad person is going to be impossible for Gendre. Sorry, Gendre. I wondered why the lapwings were... he's right over our heads. Wait, come back. Come back. It's one of my favourite raptor species, and I haven't seen them since I left. And it's a harrier hawk, and it's being thoroughly inconvenient. Come here. Oh, poor Gendre. I'm making his life so difficult. But there we go. Well done, Gendre. Everybody across the world, a round of applause for Gendre, who managed to get the harrier hawk on camera, which was not easy because he was right above us. So bravo, Gendre. And I've heard some incredible stories. Brent, of course, keeps me updated as to the goings-on whenever I'm away. And he was telling me all about the fact that the harrier hawks have been busy raiding the mud cracks of the dried dams and picking out frogs and other things that they can find there. Oh, they're just the most fascinating birds of prey. That's one of the reasons why they definitely fall in my top five favorites. They're always doing something fascinating. In this case, flying, which, you know, aerodynamically is also fascinating. And I got so distracted I missed my chance on the Game Drive channel. How devastating. Beautifully done. Well done, Gendre. You can just hear immediately the responses of the birds and the squirrels. They've got such sharp eyes and they're constantly looking for threats like that. And they started alarm calling. And this ewe has just decided to head across to where the water is pumped. Oh, or not. Or, you know, she's going to go... Oh, there we go. She's got the runoff. That's what she's after. One of the few remaining water sources for our poor, pressured animals in this dry season. Sorry, everybody. I'm just trying to wait for my opportunity to jump on board this lion sighting. No, still chatting. We'll get there eventually. Okay, let's go. Let's make our way in that direction. Excuse me. Thank you very much. I may or may not have had a slight cold while I was away. I am very much on the mend, though. Just been left with a residual hacking cough. There's been something horrible going around throughout South Africa. I'm relatively certain I caught this from my mum while I was on leave, but I know that James had it, I know Lou had it, Kirsty had it a couple of months ago, and Brent also has had it. So there's something, some horrible virus going around. And Gendre was also ill for the duration of his leave. So there we go. End of winter in South Africa. Apparently it's just the time for the viruses. Stations. I'm also going to be making my way towards the area of the Ingala, but no rush, just let me know when you're done. There we go, I managed to get a chance to talk. Oh, no problem, Tax, you're welcome to go in. Where are you now? Okay, copy. I'm coming up towards Central now, so if you don't mind, I will just go in ahead. That's all right. Copy that, thank you. Right, I'm going to have my daily dose of vitamin C, which Gendre has very kindly provided. Oh my goodness. I'm in demand this afternoon. Everyone wants to talk to me. Herbert's just telling me how to get into the sighting, which apparently is a tricky experience. Bethany, on the subject of our drought and, of course, the big rain, you have a lovely question on East recycles, and I'm going to get to that in 1 second. Just bear with me. I'm negative, but I do believe Steph checked before Zookdam. Oh, goodness. Oh, goodness gracious. I'm sorry, Bethany. There we go. Okay, so Bethany's question is, would the drought affect the estrus cycles of the various animals? Would it shorten it? Would it lengthen it? What exactly would happen? And it's a very good question because, yes, I think that it absolutely would have an effect on their reproduction, but not necessarily their estrus cycles. So I think that if all of the impala, for example, the female impala, would have gone into estrus as they usually do around that time of year, I think we're going to see a significant drop in the numbers of antelope calves and lambs that we see this year. Hello, Kudu. Aren't you lovely? What a lovely surprise. You're beautiful. So this last impala birthing season, we had far fewer lambs than we might otherwise have experienced. So usually an impala's breeding rate, around 90% of the females have babies. This year it was probably, if I had to guess, this is not an official figure, but if I had to guess, oh, look at that. He's found a bone. Sorry, Bethany. I will get... we'll be able to fully answer your question in a moment, but just have a look at this. A little bit of osteophagy in practice. Chewing on old bones to supplement its calcium intake. And in this case, it looks like the vertebra probably of a buffalo, quite possibly of an old buffalo kill from one of the lions that's been sort of scattered by the hyena activity. And munch, munch, munch away, getting those essential minerals. They can't, of course, pop down to the pharmacy, as I have done recently, and purchase their supplements. And so things like salt licks, geophagy, eating dirt, and then eating bones also helps to sort of help out with their mineral intake. In that case, of course, it would be calcium and phosphorus that they're after. Oh, cute. Look at the little one behind the male. He's got the tiniest little horns. I swear I see horns. No, I do see horns. Oh, cute. There's something about young male antelope that I find extraordinary. It's that gangly, sort of half-put-together look that they've got going on. You know, he's fluffy. He's not quite sort of fluffy enough to be a big male. And his neck hasn't really thickened. They're gangly and adolescent. And slightly sort of punk rockerish, with his crest of mane along his shoulders. Gorgeous little boy. And Bethany, it sort of brings us back to your question, because I think that you'll find not just the impala, but all of the antelope species will have a lower level or a lower success rate of fertilization. So not necessarily their estrus cycles, but a lower success rate of fertilization, and most definitely a drop in the number of females that carry their offspring to full term. And that's just because the females' bodies can't meet their nutritional requirements. Here's their little antelope. Is that Herbert? Herbert keeping a close watch, giving us his extraordinary smile. I have to tell you, there's nobody in the world that has a smile like Herbert. Isn't he wonderful? He is, of course, to thank for our lion sighting. Let's go, guys. Lovely kudu, but let us go and get to those lions before we lose our spot, which would be most tragic. And, of course, because the cubs could well be there, we have a limited time that we can spend with them before it starts to get dark and it's time for us to ship off and to ship out and to move off. Let's just have a quick chat with Herbert. Hello, Herbert. Oh, you did it again.
Yeah.
You see? Thank you, man.
Welcome back.
Thank you very much.
Hi, Janet.
It's good to be back.
Hi, everyone.
Here we go. So everybody's saying a big well done for finding those lines for us.
Oh.
We're going to go in now.
Okay. Your best approach should be from Hyena Road. I drop a good worry bush in the...
Of course. The road. It's Hyena Road.
Yeah.
Naturally. Thanks, Herbert. Well done.
Yeah.
Okay.
Enjoy, Jamie.
Sharp. Thank you very much. Cheers. I have to tell you, nothing brightens one's day quite like Herbert's smile. He really does have the most extraordinary smile. And personality, of course. I have to tell you something. All of you saying a big hello to Herbert, I'll pass that on. I have to tell you something. I think Brent's been wearing my hat. I've been trying to work out, because of course I left it here. I've been trying to work out why it keeps trying to climb down the center of my face. And it's because Brent's been wearing it. He's obviously loosened it. You know, he's got about 50 pairs of hats. Oh, not pairs of hats. Hats don't come in pairs. He's got about 50 hats. Thank you. William says that Herbert's smile is as sweet as sherbet. Sherbet, Herbert, Herbert, sherbet. Sherbet, Herbert. Agreed. He has the most extraordinary personality. I really do enjoy him. We had a lovely chat yesterday, last night. He was filling me in on all of the details of what's been going on while I've been gone. Because, of course, you always feel when you first get back after a long leave cycle, which it is necessary, and we have to get out of the bush, and we have to have a break, and we have to have some different scenery or whatever it is that we happen to go and do. But it is... you always feel a little bit behind the times when you return, wondering what you've missed. And most of us, I've found, I don't speak entirely just for myself, we start to get that fear of missing out thing that people always talk about, particularly sort of 10 days into your holiday. You start to get a bit antsy and you kind of want to know what's happening and want to go and see the animals again, spend a bit of time and just reacquaint oneself. And of course, it's always fascinating to see how much the vegetation changes in the period of 2 weeks, and it really does. Now, of course, we just need the rain. The temperature's changed, it's nice and warm, it's my favorite. This is my absolute favorite time of the year. It's perfect, the temperature's perfect. It's easy to track the animals. It would be nice if there was a bit more food and a bit more water. But generally, this is my favorite time of the year to be in the bush. And I'd love to hear from those of you, actually, who have been to South Africa before, or even actually just from watching Safari Live. I'd actually love to hear what the general consensus is. Not that all times aren't marvelous and magical, but what your favorite time is to either be out on our live safari drives, or if you have been fortunate enough to come out to Africa in person, what your favorite time of the year is to be in, particularly in the South African bush, in terms of what you can see. Because of course, each and every month and each and every season brings something new and magical. And so Jandre and myself find ourselves on Hyena Road. Once again, Jandre, what was it you told me before the lions killed a buffalo here? There we go. Nothing ever happens on Hyena Road. 2 seconds later, we had a live buffalo kill unfolding in front of our eyes. And now, of course, we're on our way to see a different buffalo kill. And of course, the big thing about going away is that one misses out on those crucial moments of development. And I'm very excited to see these little lion cubs. And Liz has sent through that I will be amazed at how much they have grown. And Liz, I do not doubt you for 1 second. I have, of course, on the odd occasion, been keeping track of the various screenshots and clips and highlight reels of whatever happens to be seen while I'm away. But there's nothing quite like seeing them up close for yourself, live on safari. So I'm very excited about this. And I have no doubt, because lion cubs do grow at the most incredible rate. We're going to be looking back 6 months down the line at our lovely Nkuhuma cubs and just bemoaning the fact that they are no longer in that cute cub stage, and yet at the same time being excited for what is to come. I've no idea where the sighting is, by the way, but I'll figure it out. Besides, Herbert very kindly dropped a quarry branch. So this is one of their favourite patches, actually. This is where we think they have been denning their cubs in the past. Now, of course, the little cubs are big enough, old enough and strong enough and scary enough to be running with the pride, which I am very excited to see. Excuse me. I'm going to try not to do that. Because once I start, then I can't stop. So I just mustn't give myself that leeway. Right. It is on the western side somewhere. There we go. And as we start to make our way in, and I warn you now, this could be quite a complicated procedure, and Tony's asked a really lovely question, which is, am I as addicted to my job as some of our regular viewers are to the show? And my answer to that is yes. The truth is, I actually really don't know. I can't imagine myself being anywhere else or doing anything else. Whenever I go back to the city, as lovely as it is to see the people there and to, well, basically to see the people there, there's nothing else really that nice about a city for me personally. But I'm always struck whenever I head back home to where I feel most comfortable, I'm always struck by this feeling of peace. As soon as I drive over the Drakensberg Mountains, it's like I can breathe again properly. Not so much this time because I've had this terrible cold, but you know what I mean. Doesn't help that the light's shining right in our eyes. Can't see where the tracks are. We'll just keep heading. We'll just keep going until we find something. You got tracks there? Perfect, thank you, Jandre. Oh, there we go. Where's going to be easiest? This way seems to be the way. It's another exciting part of the lion's development that Tony has mentioned, which is the fact that you can't wait for the young male lions to develop their mohawks. Now, Liz, of course, by the way, thank you, Liz, since you are watching, and many others have spent hours and hours going through the footage and having a look at the genders of the different cubs, the sex of the different cubs. I will remember offhand, I did double check exactly what it was, and I mean, I haven't stopped and confirmed for myself. But it does seem that we have at least two males, which is fantastic news. And yes, kind of like what I was saying with the young kudu. There's something wonderful about young male animals when they're at that early... Oh, thank you. Hello, antenna. At that early stage of development. Okay, there's Andre. Right, where do we go next? We go this way. See some impala. That is not a lion. Now, Herbert did say it was very, very tricky to get in here. It's lovely to hear, Gracie, that you are watching. Gracie is 9 years old, and while I was away, Gracie got a baby elephant called Snuggles that she gets a picture of once a month, and that I would absolutely love him. Gracie, I am certain that I would love him. That sounds wonderful, and it's lovely to hear you watching. I have very much missed you, Gracie. We'll continue this conversation once I've managed to make my way through here, because I've got some amazing stories. I did promise you some stories from my leave, so I do have some stories to tell you. Goodness gracious me. These lions have picked a spot. This appears to be the way. Perhaps Mr. Impala over there could give us some directions. Hello, Mr. Impala. No, don't go that way. That's where the lions are. No, no. No, perhaps he knows something we don't. Right. Gonna make sure that this impala goes in the right direction. I don't want to push him into the lions. Not that they're going to. Chances are they're not even going to give him a second glance with bellies full of buffalo. Oh. Here's a vehicle. A station with the Ingala for Jamie. Okay, copy that. Thank you. I think I've got your visual. Yes, got your visual. Okay, I guess we're just going to settle here for one moment because there's two vehicles in the sighting already, so they're going to be pulling out in one moment, and then we'll be able to make our way into the Nkumas and I get to see how big those cubs have got. And of course, some of the males now, because the oldest set must be what, 4 months? Nearly 5 months? No, 4 months old now. They're going to start to get that tufty little mane growth that I'm so looking forward to seeing, as Tony said. I think they're in there. Pretty sure I saw a vehicle. So, while we're here, and while we're sitting, I'll tell Gracie and, of course, all the others, but Gracie did ask me for stories of my leave while I was away. So Gracie, one of the things that I did was I went to go to Brent's parents' house and we went to go see wild dog puppies, which are the youngest I have ever seen wild dog puppies. And they were absolutely amazing, these tiny, tiny little creatures. But one of the highlights of my holiday was sitting on my mom's balcony, and she has a flat in Johannesburg, sitting on my mom's balcony and watching a southern masked weaver that I nicknamed William build his nest. And when I first arrived, so a weaver is a bird, I'll find a picture of it for you while I chat. And when I first arrived, he'd built the frame of his nest, and of course weavers build their nests so that they can attract the ladies. So the men do all the building and they wait for the females to come and find them. And in this case, William the weaver was terribly, terribly dedicated to his job. He spent hours and hours every single day perfecting this nest, and he eventually, in the 5 days that I was there, he built this perfectly round nest, filled it up with all kinds of lovely sort of, there we go, that's what a male, that's what William looked like, all sorts of lovely sort of stuffing and comfort spots and fluffiness to help soften it, and obviously in the hope of attracting the slightly drabber female. And then he would sit and sing day in and day out, waiting for the love of his life to come and join him. And whilst he managed to fend off all kinds of males, in the time that I was there, I think that William got a little bit eager. I think he built his nest a little bit too soon. But it was lovely to see, and I'm really hoping that when my mom gets back, she'll be able to tell me whether or not William's nest worked and he managed to attract a lovely lady. So we'll just have to wait and see. That's not a lion, it's an Inyala. I can hear vehicles going out. Much further to the north of where I am. Should we go and investigate? Perhaps it was not a vehicle that I saw hidden in the bushes. I don't hear any talking either. Or lions growling, so let's carry on in our search for things. And then, Gracie, I met a very special, or I was reacquainted with a very special friend who is, I'm not going to say where I saw him, where I happened to be, but his name is Palmer, and he is a very, very special animal that unfortunately we can't show on Safari Live, but it wasn't here that I saw him, and it's one of my favorite creatures. So I met Palmer, who is an old friend of mine, and an animal. What else? Oh, I had a lovely cheetah sighting, an extraordinary cheetah sighting, with two brothers. This was on the reserve that I used to work at. Calling to each other, having a marvelous time. This does look like it's the right way. In a curious turn of affairs, whoopsie, there are lions at the damn camera. Hmm. Now, apparently that could just be that they're going to go and have a drink. I'm quite far away from the damn camera now, and it's going to take me a while to be able to get out of this particular spot. Where are these tracks going? Okay, so the lion... Yeah, I've got them here, thanks. So the lions have gone for a drink, but it's probably not all of them. So what they do when they're at a kill like this is they'll take turns to go and relieve their thirst whilst one of them stays behind to make sure that there are... that there are no threats coming like hyenas to steal their kill. The wonderful news, of course, is that both Steph and myself are out here. So whilst we go and search for the buffalo kill, Steph is going to race through to the Juma Dam camera. Aha! People! Marvellous! That can only mean one thing, we're on the right track. Quite literally. Okay, let's go and say hello to Aubrey. So Steph's going to race through to the dam cam, or to the Juma Dam, have a look at those lionesses, and we'll make our way to the kill. Okay, we gotta go that way. That's going to be easiest. Now that is a very good question from Roger, who would like to know if I have any idea when that kill took place. Roger, if I had to guess, I would say probably early this morning, sometime after Steph saw them disappearing off in this direction. And the reason I say that is just statistics. So lions, of course, it is getting hotter now in the mornings. And lions, of course, don't like to be active during the hottest times of the day. But that being said, Roger, lions don't read the textbooks, do they? So I have seen the Nkuhumas hunt and kill a buffalo successfully. Wave hello to everybody. On a day that was sort of 33, 34 odd degrees, so close in the 90s Fahrenheit. Especially females, they tend to be very dedicated in terms of, well, I mean, you know, they've got to sustain themselves, and in this particular case, sustain cubs as well. So my guess would be early this morning, but I don't know for certain. And of course, that mist that we experienced would also certainly have helped us out. Oh, there we go. I did see a vehicle. It was in the right direction. Thank goodness. Not going crazy. Okie dokie. Well done to Herbert for finding this, because this is not an easy position. Okay, where are we going? I think we're going through here. Yay, I'm so excited. I'm gonna go see the lion cubs. Okay, how are we gonna do here, Jandre? Oh, there they are. Never mind. How marvelous. Look at that. It's a big buffalo. Oh. Hello, monsters. Are you getting tucked in? Just listen to the sound, sorry. As I said that, they went completely quiet. Oh, this is too magical. And they've obviously been too tired to even feed off it properly because hardly any of it's been eaten. There's cubs everywhere, emerging out of the grass. Oh, such fierce noises. That's amazing. At such a young age, already that instinct kicking in. What an extraordinary thing to witness live. Oh! Getting a deep growl from Mom there. And of course, it's every lion for himself at a carcass like this one. It means the little ones have to fight for their spot. And with their tiny little jaws, and mouths, it's not so easy to break into another part of the carcass, so they have to go and feed where there's an adult feeding already. And Mom might be a bit more tolerant, but as I noticed while I was away, there was some extraordinary, oh, look at her face. There was an extraordinary couple of sightings with male lions. Look at her face. Hot and exhausted. I would love to know when they brought this buffalo down. It's very, very fresh to me. I'll copy that, Mike. You can make your way in. It's just myself. Gosh, I don't even know which lion cubs I'm looking at now. It used to be so easy to tell them apart. It's going to get harder and harder and harder now. These must be the oldest ones, surely. Effects are just extraordinary. Sliding under Mom. So young, and yet, oh, so vicious. Gone are our little bundles of innocence, replaced by these savage little creatures, full of noise and ferocity. Look at that, hitting right into the carcass. And Cecilia, of course, is picking up on the body language of our amazing lions and watching the cubs' ears flat down against their backs. And that, of course, is also a very, very good indication of their current mood. And what's amazing about that is that whenever we watch the adult lions, that's exactly the posture that they adopt when they first start to feed. Ears flat, and those of you with cats and dogs and horses will of course know instinctively what that means. It means the animal that you're dealing with is cross and on the defensive, possibly even a bit aggressive, but usually it's sort of defensive snarling and growling. You know when your dog lays its ears flat, or when your cat lays its ears flat, and especially when a horse lays its ears flat, you might well be in for a tough time, and with lions that is no different. And the cubs are squabbling over the meat. It's tough being a little lion cub. You've got to get all that food, but you're not really big enough to fight for your place at the carcass. Luckily for them, their mothers are true huntresses. masters of catching buffalo. Now, as far as I know, with Steph, there were only three lionesses this morning. The other two were mating in Amber Eyes and the young female mating in Buffles Hook with the Birmingham boys, which means that our three lionesses managed to bring this big buffalo down on their own. Look at that cub. Clinging on for dear life. Ooh. What's up? Oh, it's got your attention. We watch our little cub making its way back towards the buffalo kill and dinner. William, who is 6 years old and watching with his mum in Johannesburg. William, it's so lovely to have you. Ooh. Scrapping. Sorry, William. I'm going to answer your question in a moment. Ooh. So William's asked a brilliant question, which is, while he's watching the cubs, he wants to know how much they could eat in one go. Now, William, typically, an adult lion, that like this big female, she could eat up to probably somewhere in the region of 7 to 10 kilograms in one big sort of meal, one big eating. She'll eat more than that over the next few days, but that would be her sort of initial stomach-bulging, gorging session. The cubs, because they're much, much smaller, it'll be a lot less than that. And you'll probably find it's only a couple of 100 grams at a time. They're still young. They are, at this point, almost completely weaned. You know, might suckle the mom's milk every now and again, but they're almost totally reliant on the meat of the buffalo, or whatever their moms happen to catch. So you're probably looking at a couple of 100 grams, which, William, is a lot of food. So think about how much you have it. Maybe you have a nice family meal sometimes when you felt your absolute fullest, as much as you've ever eaten in your whole life before. These lion cubs eat more because they have to. They never know when they're next going to get a chance to eat like this. So I'm just going to be quiet so you can hear these sounds. Sorry, F, stand by one. Oh, look at them tucking in. Oh, sorry about that. Sure. It's amazing how tough these little creatures have to be, and it's astounding how the social bonds that are so essential to the lion's survival and so incredibly strong at all other times. Look, I mean, they're not tearing into each other, but they're certainly giving each other what for. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 little ones. There's number 5 off on the edge. Apparently those females have, I think I saw number 6. Apparently those lionesses have moved away from the dam camera. So there's a good chance that they're going to be making their way back towards this kill. I didn't think they'd be gone for too long. Oh, it's just a pile of lions. It's hard to know where one begins and the other ends. What a fantastic way to come back from leave, hey, Jean-André? Not bad.
Yeah.
I'm going to see if I can reposition to get us the clearest possible view. And while I do that, Steph is back up and running. Let us find out what his plans are for this afternoon.
Welcome back. Yes, we've been cruising around Juma looking for something else to show you. And I've decided that we'd go back to Sandile and see if we can spice up Jamie's lion sighting today with a leopard sighting, just to end off the show. The light is just so beautiful today. Brian was just admiring how it reflects off of the baldness of my head at almost the same intensity that it comes from the star in question.
It's wonderful.
And so we're going to see if we can find Sandile for you. Jamie left him a little bit earlier. It looked like he was going to get up and move, but then he has a little bit of meat left. Doesn't need to drink, remembering that Sydney's dam is quite close, but he hasn't seemed to have visited it at all. And he gets all the moisture he needs from the blood and the intestines of that impala. All the moisture he needs. Yes, that's what I said. Excuse me. I'm still scatterbrained as anything today. Bit of dehydration probably. Got to get used to drinking water again as the temperature here rises. All right, we are now pretty close to where we saw him last. He's been fairly skittish with some vehicles. Reports that I'm getting from some of the cars that he's not comfortable with cars with large amounts of people on. But he's been okay with us so far. Touch wood, I think. So let's go have a look here. Erica, you've asked a nice question. Why do birds give alarm calls when they see big cats? And you've said when neither lion nor leopard hunt them. Erica, I don't understand why they alarm call at lion. They definitely alarm call it at leopard, because leopard do catch birds. Not the small, tiny little ones, but absolutely they'll go for Franklin and they'll go for anything bigger, guinea fowl. But it's a good question that in that they absolutely do alarm call for lion, and there is no real reason other than perhaps a baby lion would hunt a bird just to practice potentially. And that sets in, you know, this natural fear. So young lions will practice on birds, and so will young leopard in actual fact. So perhaps that's where it comes from. It's just this juvenile playing and exploring has just set this fear. And it was there already, because birds need to be scared of cat-like things. Especially house cats, apparently. Okay, so I immediately see that there is no more kill here. Well, or it's fallen out. So, it's just slowly, slowly. Let's just slowly, slowly see what is going on here. Now, they are so fantastically camouflaged, these cats, even in this drab bush that we have here now. He is, at first glance, nearly invisible. Right, let's go over to that termite mound. He likes that termite mound, I think, because it can give him some elevation, and it also gives him a cool spot out of the sun. All right, so let me... All right, and while we look for Sandile, why don't you go over to that lion, or that carcass with those lion cubs on it.
Carcass that is, of course, under much attention. Lion's absolutely having a ball with this particular buffalo. Sorry, go with me one moment. You might get some odd sounds and just... fiddling with my microphone. There we go. That should be better. I've now readjusted my hat to fit my own head and not Brent's. As you can imagine, his head is slightly larger than mine. Thank you. Yeah, sorry about this, everybody. I'm sure I will be 100% by tomorrow. But for now, the lingering cough has stuck with me for a little longer than expected. This lion is pulling the skin aside. It's not an easy process, devouring a buffalo. We see our lions do it on a regular basis, and that might sound like such an absurd statement, because of course that is what they rely on and live on. But that skin, the connective tissue that sort of connects the layer of skin to the subcutaneous fat layer and the various connective muscles, is unbelievably tough. It's made up of such a fibrous tissue. So to peel back that skin is actually no small feat. Even cutting into the buffalo's skin is something that the lion is equipped to do with a vast array of sharp tools, from teeth to claws. But it's not an easy process, which is why the cubs, of course, are so insistent on feeding where mom is feeding. But there are more lion cubs about. They're just hiding off in the grass, off in a drainage line. So they are around. Hello, little ones. I know it's difficult for where Gendre is to see them. I can barely see them. But I can't resist just having a look. Hey, you're still tiny. Oh, I think here are the other lions. I can hear them calling. Just listen.
Yeah. She's there.
She's there. There she is. Oh, such a difficult position. I so wish I could be there for the moment of reunion. So our lionesses that were at the dam camera have rejoined the group. Unfortunately, in the most difficult position possible. Oh, and she's lying down in the sand. You can just see cubs scrambling around. Oh, I want to go and join them. I'll go on the other side. Not join them, obviously. That's a ridiculous thing to say. That's not what I meant at all. I meant sort of find a nice position. And just bear with me for one moment. I think Mike is lost. He's been trying to find the sighting, and to be fair, it is a tricky spot. Mike, I still don't think I have your audio. Copy, Mike. When I hit the Shkova, then the track started to go south from there. Stand by one. Let me try and work it out. Poor Mike, it is a difficult sighting to find. Sorry, everybody. I'm just trying to help to guide one of the other guides into this difficult sighting. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my map, because he wants to know how far away from the other road I am. Oh, that's what I thought. Mike, I've got your audio. Keep coming south. Copy. I think I heard him. Yes. All right, so basically what I'm just doing here is helping one of the other guides to find the sighting. As I said, it's a tricky spot. There we go. There we go. He's on his way. Fantastic. And we can go back to focusing on our lovely lion family. It is extraordinary how fast these lion cubs have grown. And as I said, in the next few months, they'll barely be recognizable as the cute little bundles of fluff that we once knew. Next on my list, of course, is the Styx cubs and Karuda's cubs. But I feel as though this, for an afternoon welcome back from 2 weeks' absence, is not a bad way to go. Starting off with Sindile, the lovely male leopard, and now sitting with our lion pride as the female tears into her buffalo carcass. Ooh, you know what they haven't done yet? Ooh, let's just listen. They haven't got around to actually taking out the stomach contents, the intestines in the stomach. Now, generally, that is the first thing that animals, predators, do when they kill something, is they remove the intestines, because as soon as that animal dies, they start the gases within, as part of the normal digestive process, the gases and the bacteria within the buffalo start to go into overdrive and the gases build up. And you get an almost explosive situation. Now, I'm not too concerned for the safety of Gendre and myself just yet, but at some point they're going to have to burst open that stomach cavity because it is swollen. On a hot day like lioness. I don't know if this is Mom or if this is one of the other lionesses, but she's looking terribly unimpressed with their boldness. Where's Mike gone? I can't hear him anymore. Oh dear. Sorry everybody, please hold on one moment. Mike, I've lost your audio again. Okay, copy, Mike. Sorry, everybody. I don't want to detract from the sighting. Some amazing vocals coming from these lions. And James Bear, a lovely question coming through from you. Something that we've noticed, particularly with the Ikuhumas, as far as we know, there's only three lionesses here. Sorry. Destined to listen to the sounds of these incredible animals. Sorry, James. Every time I start to talk, they make another amazing sound, and I don't want to talk over it. Right, James's question is, could her hyenas come and push the lions off this buffalo kill? So gross. Yes, James, absolutely they could. And what we've noticed with the Nkumas is that they're very careful, particularly with these little cubs. Now, they're getting to the age where they're a lot more resilient, they're a lot faster, they're a lot... Oh! Such cheeky creatures. But with an absence of the males and with two females missing from their ranks, you might find that they could be pushed off this carcass. But generally, hyenas are not fools, and you really, really don't want to tangle with a lioness with a brood of cubs. We've seen what they've been doing to the males over the last few days or the last few weeks, whenever the males happen to overstep the boundary. Hyena is much, much smaller than a male lion. Lions are a lot of sound and fury, but often it doesn't translate into major action. So although what we're seeing looks so terribly vicious and unfair, the female hasn't hurt the cubs in any way. And even in the fights that we've seen between the adults, they usually pull their punches. Unless it is a really serious territorial fight or something similar. Generally it's sort of bats about the face and the nose, but they don't do the full damage that they would be able to or would be capable of inflicting in a serious situation. You might find that these females will abandon this buffalo carcass. I don't think so though. I think between the three of them they'll be able to stave off the hyenas. Look at this cub climbing Mount Buffalo. It's a climbing lesson and a meal all rolled into one. Now I think I can hear Mike. Mike, is that your audio? FM. Just keep coming south. We're probably about 50 meters away from you. We're just hidden in this gwari thicket here. And Laura, lovely to have you on board the Sunset Safari. My apologies for the interruptions. However, you want to know how many cubs I can see? 2, 3, 4. Laura, I'm relatively certain that all 8 of them are here, but I can only see the larger ones. I think the youngest 3 have gone down to suckle. The female that I can see in the drainage line, she's got her legs up in the air. That sort of a typical nursing posture. There we go, one. What have we got here? There's two females. So all three moms are here, as they were this morning. And I'm pretty sure we've got all eight cubs, but I've only counted six definitely. And in a wonderful turn of affairs, we've managed to, Mike has managed to find us. Oh, such an angry lioness. Look at those teeth. That cub baring its teeth at her. I love them at this age. They are so full of attitude. Hello. Hello, you. Long time no see. Look how you've grown. With your blue eyes. Those are not going to last, but they are gorgeous. Oh, and Mr. Snarly over there, giving Mom a little bit of a lesson in etiquette. Look at their claws. They're such amazing creatures. Oh. See, it's mostly just sound and warning. Its head right into the carcass. Here we go. Mom's making life a lot easier. Pulling back the skin. Ooh. Her instinctive reaction, of course, is she's been throughout her entire life fighting for her place at the carcass. So, of course, her reaction is to snarl and growl at the cub. But there's no real menace to it. It does just make her look terrifying, particularly with a face full of blood like that. Of course, it doesn't help that the cub is really making her life difficult. Oh, and she has abandoned her post to allow the cub to tuck into its meal. Panting away. Now, James and many others. Oh, here comes another lioness. Here she comes. Is she going to go and join in? Because then we could get some serious fireworks around the carcass. Let's just see what she decides to do. Trailed by cubs. I just feel as though there's cubs everywhere. Oh, there's mom number two standing up at the back. And there's the little ones. Oh, I barely got to see them before I went away. The youngest members of the Nkuhuma Pride. Oh, flopped down. They've still got their spots on them. Oh, absolutely stunning. Hello, little. That must be a middle one. Or one of the older ones. That's going to be very hard to keep track of them all. What an extraordinary welcome back. We may have had the gremlins, but we've also had a fantastic afternoon. And to see our beautiful Nkuhuma cubs is the way that I wanted to start off my work cycle. Now, Mr. Henry is, of course, back once again on Juma. From his adventures in the Mara. But don't tell him I said this, but I really think he might have been right all along. I think that lion cubs may well just be the cutest cat. Baby cat, that is. I think he may have got that spot on. Look at that cub. Thoroughly determined to have a meal. That's incredible how much they've grown. Cast your mind back to the first time we saw the first three Nkuhuma cubs all lined up in a row on Nyala Road North. I'm using her rasping tongue to strip away meat from bone. A cub has since given up. I've decided that that is his lot in life. And it's not quite worth the energy just yet. And what a treat this is going to be first thing tomorrow morning. Perhaps it'll be all misty again. and we'll get to have lions on a buffalo kill in the mist. Or perhaps is that just getting a little bit greedy now? Asking a little bit much. One thing is for sure, though, I think there's a very good chance they're still going to be here tomorrow morning. Especially since our hyena clan has moved further north into Manuleti. Excuse me. So Dark Knight raises a question that has come through many times in the past and is a very, very good question. And that is, what? Every time I start to talk, the cubs start to make a noise. I don't know what to do, I'm so torn. So Dark Knight wants to know why, if we name the individual leopards, do we not name the individual lions and lionesses? Tradition is sort of the general answer, and also in terms of the way that the reason that lions are named and leopards are named. Leopards are solitary, so they move about on their own, so they get their own individual names. Lions are social cats, so they're named for their pride or their coalition, depending on if they're male or female. And it's just a sort of a way of generally referring to them. So it's just a social versus a solitary thing. That being said, Dark Knight, most of our viewers have come to know each and every individual lioness in the Nkuhuma Pride personally. And whilst they don't have any official names, although I think Amber Eyes, given her current viral status throughout the internet, I think that Amber Eyes' name is pretty much official. We don't name them necessarily, but in our heads we do. We can identify each and every individual. I mean, we also started naming the hyenas, contrary to sort of reserve tradition. But it made life so much easier in terms of identifying each and every individual. And for me, because I've just spent the most amount of time, I think, of any of the other lions on this reserve, I've spent the most amount of time with the Nkuhumas. I've come to know them as individuals rather than as a collective. Whereas, for example, if I were to encounter another lion pride, unless I spent considerable period of time with them, they for me would be a collective rather than a group of individuals. So while our lioness tucks in and we enjoy our last few moments of the sunset safari with her, let's head back to Steph and find out what Sindile is up to. It's a big cat afternoon.
Definitely is a big cat afternoon there, Jamie, and we have been spending a fantastic time with Sindile the leopard on the termite mound, very close to where he had the leftovers of his kill. I cannot see anything of his kill. I don't know where it is. Beautiful evening sky that Brian's busy showing us there. And have a look. Ta-da! Leopard all of a sudden magically appears out of the darkness. I can't actually see any piece of the kill left anywhere. I mean, he may have covered it. Leopard quite often will scratch leaves over a kill. It's not in the tree anymore that he had treated in, and it's very possible that he's actually finished it. He's been here now for 3 days, and that's more than enough time for a leopard to finish an impala. And I'm fully expecting to stand up as soon as it gets full dark and move off, even if it's just a short distance away. He's been defecating and urinating. The impala's been rotting around here. And there's a pervasive smell of leopard. And he will be wary enough after having survived these last 23 months to know that he needs to move out of this area to stay safe. Not breathing as hard as he was yesterday, at least whenever we were here. We were here early this morning in the mist. And then he still had a back leg left of impala. Those whiskers come forward. For those of you who are noticing that, you watched him. There we go. Little burp. Watch, he puts those whiskers forward. That's how he senses the world around him. In the pitch black, those whiskers will come forward like that and will touch and probe any openings in the bush in front of him and allow him to move absolutely silently through gaps that he can fit into. You can see those whiskers on his eyebrows. Look at that. Oh, that's a brilliant shot. For those of you quick enough, see if you can get a picture of his whiskers pointing forward, then there we go. There you go. That's fantastic. That is not a picture that you often see. Normally, normally these leopard are not caught looking out of sorts with their whiskers out. It makes them look quite comical. They're normally very sleek. There he goes again. That fly. Oh, yes, go again. Oh. That is just such a fantastic picture. You can even see he's got some whiskers on his cheeks. All designed to allow him to gauge a space that his body will fit through in near pitch blackness. Then underneath his eyes, on his bottom eyelid, you'll notice a white stripe. That is there to reflect starlight into his eyes, allowing him to see a better picture. He's now walking straight at us. We're just going to sit still. I don't quite know the reaction that he's going to have to us. He's coming to me. I'm not going to finish talking. He must know that I'm... Oh, he's going to have a wee. Contented cat. Oh, look at that. He's got a bit of a scar. Is that a scar? Yes, it's a scar on top of his nose. That, in years to come, will be diagnostic. You can see our Land Rover reflected in his eyes. We're just going to sit still. Sit still. Don't move at all. I'm just busy speaking to Brian. It's going to be hard for him not to move while we're turning the camera. Roger, you've just asked me if he's likely to start sawing anytime soon. Roger, I'd say he's probably a year or so away from sawing. And for those of you who don't know what sawing is the name that we give to a leopard's roar. It sounds like a rasping wood saw. And is very, very distinctive. Carries, funnily enough, quite far. And there he moves off. I actually think that he's going to leave. Going into a monkey orange thicket, which is near impenetrable for us. And let's just see where he's going to go, if he's going to come out. I'm busy watching him. We can now move. But he gave us these weary eyes. I must be honest. Leopard that have had a history like Sandile has, where he lived in very close proximity to humans in his quarantine facility at Moholoholo, I have a distrust of them. And it's because they lose that instinctive fear of humans and will gauge us and our weaknesses very, very finely. And I don't want to be close to a leopard that is not scared of people, because he realizes we're just mushy pieces of skin covered in cotton clothing rather than the dangerous predators that we are. He is moving to another termite mound. I wonder if he hasn't stashed his kill on top of another termite mound. Let's go and follow him a little bit. We won't be able to stick with him for too long. This monkey orange thicket is a big one. But anyway, following 8 minutes of this drive, let's see if we can stick with him. All right, now I'm going to get myself into a pickle here. Let's see. I don't need to disturb your peace there, guy. You can see him standing on top of that termite mound. That is a classic leopard pose on top of a termite mound, in particular for a male leopard. Oh, that is so beautiful. Take some pictures now, everybody. I'm not expecting Sandile to just up and leave. He's shown remarkable homing capacity in coming back here after being away for so long. And while he's 23 months old, and I expect him to leave within the next 6 months, you never quite know where his wanderings are going to take him. He's fully independent at the moment. His mother, Shadow, has got a new cub to look after. And although he's adjacent to her territory, she does sometimes come to here. And it's not impossible that she may have even killed this impala and brought him to it. But just have a look at this leopard on top of this termite mound. Isn't that just a fantastic picture? Just have to say well done to Brian. There's these coffee table things that you see. Barring the fact that I've managed to place us with the only piece of grass in front of his face. Oh, that's fantastic. He would just be using the termite mound as a bit of elevation. It gives him a nice viewpoint over the bush. I understand fully what he does. I've done it myself on countless occasions and tracked many countless leopard up onto the crests of these building-sized termite mounds. And there he has a bit of a sleep. And that's precisely what I expected him to do, is move away from this pervasive smell of impala death and leopard and dung and urine and go on top of a termite mound where he could quite easily sleep the rest of the night, keeping a weather eye and ear open for any disturbance. But, and rightly so, hyena and lion will most likely go to the site of the kill, giving him advanced warning and the ability to slip off unnoticed. Just as he closes his eyes on top of this fantastic termite mound after this fantastic day, a real cat-filled day. It's been, I haven't seen this many cats in one day for the last decade, and I haven't seen this many cats in the last 6 months of guarding over here. So it's been a leopard-filled day for myself and Brian. And I just want to say thank you to all of you once again. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your questions, and thank you for showing such an interest in what we do. So from me and from Brian and the thumb, I just want to say thank you once again. And from wherever you are in the world, please have a fantastic day. We'll catch you again in the morning at 6 o'clock.
And for the last few moments of the sunset safari, the sun has provided just enough light for us to spend the last few minutes with this fantastic lion pride with their cubs and their buffalo kill. Now, of course, for new viewers, we do not spotlight the or put a light on the young cubs, just to avoid adding an extra level of distraction at a time when they are so young and vulnerable. Of course, as night starts to fall, our biggest scavengers start to roam about. I am, of course, talking about male lions, but leopards as well, and of course, the spotted hyena. And we want to make sure that we do nothing to disrupt the lives of these amazing creatures, so we'll be leaving them very shortly as soon as we finish off the sunset safari. But what a fantastic afternoon it has been! A reunion with Sindile, the male leopard. I know that Steph's been commenting on all the cats we've had, but it sounds as though while I've been away, the cats have been keeping you quite thoroughly entertained. So I'm glad I've come back and I've got a chance to... Oh! Such a fierce, deep sound for such a tiny, harmless-looking creature. You little monsters. Aren't you wonderful? So a very special reunion with Sindile and with the Nkuhuma cubs, looking as beautiful as ever, and of course our lovely Nkuhuma ladies that have done a marvelous job once again of providing for their growing family. Just imagine that, 8 little growing tummies to fill over the next few weeks and months. But then of course, if all goes according to plan, they will have 8 extra members to supplement the size of the wonderful Nkuhuma pride. And we could have, what would that be? Goodness, my brain's on holiday still. This is be 13, right? I'm not crazy. No, that would be 13. Okay, so there might be some males, so they might leave. I promise you I used to be able to do maths at one point. It's a bit of a struggle. I am still on holiday, clearly. But yes, a 13-strong Nkuhuma pride in the future to look forward to. Continue to go from strength to strength, which is particularly wonderful after all of the challenges that every lion pride faces at some point in their lives. Hey, little ones, have a good evening. Enjoy your buffalo dinner. Rather new than me, I have to say. Particularly when that stomach content explodes, which is going to happen, and is potentially going to shower some poor hapless cub in grass and intestines, which actually would be thoroughly entertaining to watch, I have to say. Maybe a bit gross, though. Perhaps we'll be fortunate enough to witness that and other marvelous things on the Sunrise Safari tomorrow morning. You'll just have to stay tuned in a couple of hours to find out what happens. I'm going to safely put my things online and say that I think they're going to be there. So thank you to all of you for sending through your welcome backs for myself and for Jandre, of course. It is wonderful to be back in your company and, of course, their company once again. And a big thank you on that note to Jandre for his fantastic camera work. It's good to have him back. Oh, so nice to be back. I can't describe it. It's just such a fantastic feeling of well-being. And a big thank you to Kirsty and to Lou in Final Control. And most importantly, a big thank you to all of you joining us and watching across the globe. I hope you've had a marvelous time. Thank you for sticking with us with the Gremlins today. I'll see you tomorrow on the Sunrise Safari.